Everybody look alert. Well, lots of alert lookings from you.
This is the star of our show.
That's Peter's star.
Talking of alerts. 9, 8, smile, 6, 5.
Good morning. Yes, a very good morning to you. It's 9:30 and Saturday morning is music morning. Presenting the Swap Shop Choir. 1, 2, 3.
Good morning to you. Good morning to you. And welcome to Swap Shop. Good morning to you.
It's like the Nolan sisters, but with a bit more... Good morning. Here we go. What a lovely way to start the programme. Very musical. That set the pop industry back a few years. Good morning. Welcome to Swap Shop. They are, of course, not the choir, but the phone people. And they are ready to take your calls. You can see at the moment they are busy taking calls on 01 811 8055. Please dial very, very carefully. And don't forget the 01 if you're outside London. And I hope that somebody has done the right thing and got through on line 4. Hello?
Hello.
Good morning. Who are you?
David Smith.
Good morning to you, David. What can I do for you?
I'd like to ask you a question.
Certainly, fire away.
which place would you most like to visit where you haven't been before in the world?
Oh, where would I most like... I think I'd end up saying America, somewhere in America. I've always wanted to go to the west coast of America. I've been to New York many years ago, but I've heard so much about it that I'd love to go over there. And it sounds... I know someone who lives there, and they say that it's a great place to live. But I must admit, I'm very, very pleased with where I'm living at the moment. Have you got any dreams in that line?
Well, I'd like to go to Disneyland.
To Disneyland?
Yeah.
But you actually said to me, live. I mean, where would you live if you had to reside somewhere other than the UK?
Oh, New York.
You'd live in New York?
Yeah.
Crumbs. It's a very bustling, busy and slightly violent place at times, you know. But that would be your dream, would it?
Yeah.
All right, David. Well, you never know. It might come true one day. Where do you live now?
Leicester.
You live in Leicester?
Yeah.
Oh, well, a very good morning to Leicester. Thanks for the call. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. And thank you indeed to everyone who sent in Valentine's to us. We had loads and loads of Valentine's cards, and we can't obviously say a big thank you to all the individual ones. Well, I mean, they're meant to be anonymous anyway, aren't they? But many, many thanks to everyone who sent in cards. A lot of them were obviously made by people and were tremendously good. I mean, really sporting spirit. Thank you. We're most grateful for all the kisses and things. And then I got a... Well, let's be honest, a rather tatty piece of paper from Baljit. And Baljit says, Dear Swap Shop, please, will you tell me what to do with this? Not the bit of paper, but this. That thing there. You, any ideas what could be done with that? I had an idea that possibly one could get a sort of flexible plastic container and fill it with a small piece of soap and a lot of water and shake it up and down until you've got sort of virtually liquid soap, and then if you jam that on the top of it, when you squeeze the container below, the liquid would come out of there, and then you could use it for oiling bicycles and things like that. Other than that, I really haven't got an idea, Baljit. Well, I do have an idea, but I wouldn't dare say it on the television. And now, from Ashley, who's in Dryden Street, Swindon, in Wiltshire, says, here are some cows for you. And he's not joking. I got rather a large quantity of cows sent in. Thank you very much, Ashley. It fits in with one of my guests on the programme this morning. Oh, they're lying down, standing up, and there's Frisians, and there's a... Is that a Guernsey? I do believe it is. Yes, one of my guests is very much in the animal mould. I'll tell you more about that in a little while. But while we're talking of cows, this picture has been sent in to me. Have a look at this. It's come in from Michelle and Peter Thrower, who are near Sittingbourne in Kent, and they both say, what were you saying to Ermyntrude? Well, that is my Ermyntrude, and in fact, at that moment, we were discussing Tony Blackburn's singing, and I was saying, he sounds a bit like this, and Ermyntrude was saying, no, he sounds more like... That was the story behind that. Morning, Mags!
Hello!
What have you got there?
I'm going to stun you. I've got this fantastic trick,
mm-hmm.
Right? On my hand, 1, 2, 3, 4... five pieces of paper, right?
Yes.
Now, I can blow any number off my hand. You say a number between one and five, and you don't say five because it'd be easy to blow all of them off, wouldn't it?
Right.
And I will just blow the required number off my hand.
Could you please blow three off your hand?
Three. Right. Amazing, isn't it? You stunned? John Solis, eat your heart out, that's what I say.
I've got a feeling you might be doing more of those later.
Lots more.
Let's move on. Keith. Now, where is Keith? Well, actually, I do know where Keith is this week. He's in a place I know extremely well, a big building right in the centre of London. He's not doing any swapping there, but he's taken the outside broadcast cameras for a live visit. It's National Radio 1. And from action in London West 1 to space action in Battle of the Planets at 10:30. And if, like me, you're keen on all creatures great and small, you'll want to meet the man behind the scenes, TV vet Eddie Straton. He'll be here to answer your animal calls, so ring Eddie on 01811 8055. And if you fancy a laugh, Deputy Dog will be here in 20 minutes.
Mm-mm, just ripe for picking, Tycoon. I'll hold the basket. You boys climb up and shake.
We're shaking it, Musky.
Read all about it, or rather, hear the results of the great Swap Shop newspaper competition. And at about 10 to 12, you can meet a very funny lady, June Whitfield.
Chucking stones at it.
Hey, Terry, isn't that my calendar?
Well, it was your calendar. Now it's the only radar scanner in the world that strains greens at speed.
June will be here to take your calls on 01811 8055.
There's just one thing, darling.
What?
Well, I hardly like to mention it.
What?
How are you going to get it out of the kitchen?
Have you room on your shoulder for a stopping hysterical wreck?
And Rocky Sharp have made a new record. Come flying with Skybird and Neil Diamond.
Nightbird, find your way. For none may know it just as you may. Seek out your harbor of light. Let your song be heard. Rally each heart to the sight of your silver wings.
And climbing the charts again, Cliff Richard and Carrie.
Oh, I appreciate you're busy. And time's not your own. Maybe it would be better if I telephoned. Carrie doesn't live here anymore. Carrie used a room on the second floor. Sorry that she left, no forward in a dress that was known to me. Carrie doesn't live here anymore. You could always ask at the corner store. Carrie had a date with her own kind of face. It's plain to see. And
I'm him. Yes, I knew from the yes, it's back to the 50s with Rocky Sharp and the Replays.
You've been mine and I'm him.
Yes, I knew from the start.
From the start.
You were the one for me.
Ba, ba, ba.
Yes, indeed. We've got an awful lot to get through this morning. And Maggie, what are you doing?
I was painting my toenails.
You're doing what?
Painting my toenails. It's not my idea. not my idea at all. It's Tara Lodwick's idea.
Tara Lodwick?
Yes. I opened an envelope from Tara, and it came from Peterborough, and two of these things were in it, and I couldn't think what on earth they were, and I read her letter, and she said that she'd sent me something to paint my toenails with. It's gruesome.
It's a little device for holding one's tooties apart, is
it? I mean, I never paint my toenails, but I suppose it must be very difficult if you don't... I suppose if you take that out, perhaps they all run into each other or something.
Maybe they do, particularly if you've got ugly feet. What numbers? What numbers are your toenails?
Well, I'm just doing this one in number six.
Number six, red. Jelly, yeah, jelly.
It's very messy when you try to put this back in.
Does it feel comfortable?
No, it feels really... It feels like your feet are deformed when you put it on.
I must try that. I paint my toenails.
Do you?
No. No, I don't know why I said that. Now, what's this? Do you know what that is?
Give in. No, it's a radio.
It's a radio. Well done. And Keith is on the radio this morning.
No, he's not. He's on the television.
Now, he's on the radio.
He is?
Yes, he's... Keith is on the radio.
On the way to Saffron.
Here he is.
I'm actually on the radio. Good morning, Noel.
Morning, Keith.
How are you this morning?
Excellent, thank you.
Very good. I wish Maggie had washed her feet before she came on. It really is a bit much, that, isn't it?
I did.
Did you?
Yes.
They look quite clean.
They don't look too clean to me. It's what you might call a feet worse than death.
Oh.
Anyway, Noel, I'm not out and about this week. I'm what you might call in and around. And today I'm in the biggest radio station in Europe, home of Radio 1, 2, 3 and 4. I'm in the BBC's broadcasting house in Portland Place. And by the way, I'm not swapping this morning, so please don't come down to see me, as unfortunately it's not open to the public and you won't be able to get in this morning. But what we are going to do today is give you an insight into what radio is like. At this very moment, I'm in the control room for the output of sounds from Radio 1, 2, 3 and 4. As you can see there, lots of dials and digits and knobs for our fellas here to work on. They work here 24 hours a day, and I'm told, and I don't believe it, that they do a grand job. Only joking, fellas. Anyway, not only are they responsible for the sound of radio here, they're also responsible for the sound on television, outside broadcast mainly, like Grandstand, and they're even responsible for the sound on Swapper Armour each week. What happens is, when I'm on Swapper Armour, the sound from where I'm chatting and talking comes into this control room here, just feeding my wires away like mad over here, comes into this. Can you... Super, don't you, fellas? There you go. Put them all to work this morning. What happens is the sound comes into here and then it's sent out all over the country. I'll tell you what, it's quite handy to have a copy of your Radio Times when you're walking around here, because we're going to move on now and show you all four radio stations, hopefully. And just looking at my Radio Times, first of all for Radio 3, which is on the right of me here, there's a programme which is a recorded programme called Record Review. There's Radio 3, and their programme announcer this morning is Victor Hallam. There he is, reading a book. I was going to say hard at work and all. But no, basically what a programme announcer does is, because it's a tape programme, he comes on and links the programmes together. He turns around, I'm sure you've all heard it, and says, there you go, that was blah, 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 and now for another programme like this one. I'll tell you what, let's pop into Radio 3 and see how they're getting on this morning. So, if you'd like to walk round here, here we go. Super, fellas, thank you. Good morning, Clive. Well, you're the engineer for Radio 3 this morning. How's it all going?
Well, we're broadcasting off tape at the moment. We've got tape machines at the back here that we use.
What does an engineer do, Clive?
Well, I suppose we're primarily concerned with the quality that's broadcast. We have these enormous speakers that we listen to all day. We also set the tapes up.
So it sounds good at home on your radio?
Oh, yes.
All right, keep up the good work, Clive. Radio 3 is, of course, one of my favourite programmes, because I do like to listen to pop music, but I occasionally like to switch over to the Radio 3 and listen to some classical music. And here is a station that plays lots of good music. They have famous names on their station like Terry Wogan, David Hamilton, and recently, Ed Stewart. And David Jacobs is on the air at the moment, and... Oh, no, hold on, I think they're a little bit busy, so I'll tell you what, we'll leave that and move on to another well-known station, Radio 4, and this is their home. They've got an engineer as well, and I'm not quite sure what programme's going out this morning. What is it, David?
It's a programme about leisure called Breakaway with Barry Norman.
Oh, a film night fame?
Yes, yes, and it's on tape programme, yes.
Yes, and how are Radio 4 doing today?
It's very well, thank you, yes, trundling on.
Any problems?
No, all's well at the moment.
You've got your programme announcer in there at the moment, haven't you, as well?
Yes, he's called Peter Jefferson.
Yes, he looks hard at work there. Hello, oh, yes. Peter, give me a wave there. Anyway, the station that we've come to have a very good look at this morning is on 275 and 285, better known as the happy sound of Radio 1. And here it is. The lights aren't on at the moment, so that means Tony Blackburn isn't talking. He's doing Junior Choice at this very moment in time. And he did say if I was around to pop in and say hello. Is it okay to pop in there, fellas?
Yeah.
Great, super. And one chap I do know very well is his producer, Don George. Morning, thank you for holding the door, sir. Right. And good morning, Tony.
Hello, Keith. How are you?
Oh, very well. How's the show going today?
Oh, marvellous. Just playing Captain Beaky.
Oh, super. Yes. Noel's favourite record, isn't it?
It is, I believe.
Well, you've just taken over Junior Choice.
That's right.
Are you enjoying it?
Oh, fabulous time, yeah. Having a marvellous time. I've got to wave to all the Junior Choice listeners because I said I'd wave. Yes, hello.
Where's Arnold this morning?
Arnold, he knew that you were coming, and he's disappeared out. He's very camera shy.
Well, I know you're on Saturday and Sunday as well.
Yes, that's
right. You're very busy on Sunday, aren't you?
Very busy. Yeah, absolutely. I do, because I do the Top 40 show as well. I think the record's coming down.
I'll leave you to it.
All right, we'll just get them on. Give them all a nice say hello. Come on and say hello.
Shall I say hello in your microphone there?
Oh, can you see us? Here we are. Here's Keith Chegwin. And this is where we do all the show from.
And can I say a very good morning to everybody who's listening to Radio 1?
Lovely. It's nice to have them with us.
Yes, and thank you for letting us in,
Tony.
Hide
them on the colour swap shop.
Super. Thank you very much,
Tony.
Get
another record on.
All right. Well, as you can see, I don't know if you see the clock there, it says it's 10:15. And on after Tony Blackburn this morning is Peter Powell. And he's kindly let us into his studio this morning. We're not only going to be there just for a couple of minutes, we're going to be with him right the way throughout the morning, watching how Radio 1 works. Peter's sort of setting things up. Can I just pop in? Peter, is it all right to pop in and say hello?
I think so. It's very good only, though.
I promise. Right, if you'd like to walk this way, let me introduce you to a very good friend of mine. Hiya, Peter.
Hello.
Peter, you're on the air in about 14 minutes' time. What sort of preparations are you doing?
The preparation is for the balance of the programme. Very vital, because we have to make sure that the records all equalise nicely and go out in a good signal, and also the voice is balanced. In other words, the tone is just right.
Right.
And we can do a little, few noughties to the voice. We can put a little bit of echo on to make it sound just sting across a little bit better.
Well, hopefully we'll be able to hear that a little bit later on.
Yes,
I will, actually. As I say, you're going on there in a few minutes' time. Do you get nervous before you go on the air, Peter?
Do I get nervous?
Yeah.
Do I get nervous? No, I think the heartbeat sort of tends to start beating a little bit faster as it comes towards the hour. And then about 15 seconds before it goes, and then it stops. That's it.
Tell me, Peter, what sort of things are you going to be doing this morning?
We've got a system whereby we phone out poor, unsuspecting people to ask them to do their own dedication.
I see.
And we should be getting hold of a few of those between 10 and 1.
All right, well, let me just tell everybody, please don't phone Swap Shop this morning, because that is for Peter's show and Peter's show only, so don't phone Swap Shop today. But anyway, right. Peter, we're going to be joining you live on the air in about an hour's time, so we'll see you all then. But meanwhile, it's back to a guy who's no stranger to this studio. No.
Very much indeed, Keith. Thanks a lot. And I can imagine the chaos in various homes up and down the country. We always get letters from parents who say, you should see the state of our lounge after Swap Shop. The kids rushing around watching television. This morning they'll be listening to the radio as well. We will be going back to Peter's programme, part of the world I know very well indeed. The studio you saw Tony Blackburn in will be the one that I'll be occupying tomorrow morning for my radio show. So now you've got a little bit of an idea what goes on. But as I say, we'll go back in a while. Justin Turrell. Hello, Justin. He's in Whitehaven. And Justin, I've got Rocky Sharp just for you. Here he comes.
From the start, from here to eternity, you've been mine, and I knew, yes, I knew from
from the start.
From the start.
From here to eternity, you've been mine and Adam.
Yes, I knew.
From the start.
From the start.
That you were the one for me. From the start. That you were the one for me.
Yes, Rocky Sharp and the Replays. Hello, line one.
Hello.
Hello, who are you?
Amanda Berg.
Good morning, Amanda. What can I do for you?
I'd like to make a swap.
You're in the swap business, are you? Jolly good. Let me get my pen ready. Amanda, what are you offering?
A doll's house.
A doll's house?
With furniture.
Doll's house with furniture. Is it a nice house?
Yes.
Semi-detached or detached?
Detached.
Very good. And what are you hoping to get?
Some foreign stamps.
Some foreign stamps?
Yes.
You are a philatelist, are you?
Yes.
Spell philately.
No.
Woo! Any particular countries you want the foreign stamps from?
No.
You're quite easy, are you?
Yes.
Jolly good. There we go, Amanda. That'll be on our board a little bit later. At the moment, you can see the board is bristling with total inactivity. It is bare, naked, nude, and furthermore, hasn't got anything on it. But that'll come up on the board later, Amanda. Thank you very much for your call.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Now, I know that I've got someone else on the phone here, and I certainly hope that it's Jacqueline Wheeler. The reason I mentioned Jacqueline is that Jacqueline's in Purley in Surrey and says, I was on the top 10 swaps a couple of months back. I wanted a glockenspiel, and I was offering a record player. And you said, would you please play for me on the glockenspiel if I manage to master it? Or worse that effect. Well, I hope she's here. Jacqueline?
Hello?
I thought it'd be you. Have you managed to get to grips with the glockenspiel?
Yes.
You have. Right, could you play something for me down the telephone?
Yes.
You could? Mm-hmm. How are you going to manage this? Who's holding the phone?
Well, I've put it down on something.
You put the phone down on something?
Yes.
All right, for the benefit of anyone who doesn't understand, what exactly is a glockenspiel?
It's a musical instrument similar to xylophone, but it's got metal keys on it.
I see. It's sort of like a Scottish xylophone, is it? All right, have a go at playing. What are you going to play for us?
This old man.
This old man, right. Fire away. You still there? Oh. Sing along at home. Follow the bouncing ball. Very good. Excellent. Telephone operators up and down the country are now applauding you. Very good, Jacqueline. How many tunes can you play altogether?
I played quite a few at Christmas, and I can play some others as well.
We'll have to try and master some of the classics, and then we'll link you up with the London Symphony Orchestra. All right. Thank you very much indeed for being on the phone. Bye-bye.
Yes. Could you send me your Maggie, Keith and John's autograph, please?
Seeing you had the nerve to ask, yes, you'll be the only one of the day. All right? I'll send that off to you. Bye-bye, Jacqueline.
Bye.
See, we bring you the arts on this programme. Music down the phone. Line five. Five? Come on, five.
Hello?
Hello? Who's asleep on five?
Elizabeth Palmer.
Come on, Elizabeth, you've got to pick it up a bit. What can I do for you this morning?
I'd like to make a swap, please.
Swap time. Jolly good. You're not going to play a musical instrument down the telephone?
No.
Can you play anything?
Yes.
What's your instrument?
The flute and the piano.
Flute and the piano? That's an interesting combination. Can you play the piano and the flute at the same time?
No.
Would be tricky. What are you offering, Elizabeth?
I'm offering a Cindy doll.
A Cindy doll.
Two outfits and her wardrobe.
Two outfits and her wardrobe. Right. Moving out. And what are you hoping to get for the Cindy doll?
Anything to do with Peanuts.
Anything to do with Peanuts. The cartoon character Peanuts, presumably. You don't want bags of them, do you?
No.
No, quite. All right, Elizabeth, that one will be on the board a little bit later, along with five letters that we've had sent in during the week. Thank you very much indeed, Elizabeth. Good luck with the flute and the piano.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Now we've got a telling tale that has come in from Susan Hacking of Accrington in Lancashire, who says, did you know Swap Shop is a dangerous programme to watch? My sister Diane says so. She was watching you on Saturday morning and you made her laugh, and as she turned, her neck seemed to pull a muscle. and her neck would not go back, so Mum had to take her to hospital, and they put a big white collar on her. So Mum said, this week we'll sit her the opposite way round, and hopefully you'll make her laugh, and her neck might go the right way. Well, it's a thought. I hope you're all right. It is a thought, isn't it? I hope you're all right this morning, Diane. There is a further thought that, of course, your head could fall off completely. I've had a joke sent in that might make you laugh, might do the trick. It's Stephen, who's in Padiham, I think that is, in Lancashire. And he sent in a stunning joke. Ready, Diane? Face away from the television, neck upright. Where does a 10-foot budgie sleep? Where does a 10-foot budgie sleep?
I don't know.
Anywhere he wants to. I don't think it did the trick, did it, Diane? Stay that way, and I'll try and get you a little bit later with another one. Had a lot of jokes sent in. If you want to phone us this morning, that incredible man, Eddie Straighton, is with us. He does all the advice on the veterinary things behind All Creatures Great and Small. And you can give him a ring on 01-811-8055. But for now, all cartoon freaks, Anthony Payne included. He's at Compton Park, Manor Mead in Plymouth. Here we've got Deputy Dog. Deputy Dog right now.
My head bone.
Deputy Dog, more cartoon fun to come in a moment, but now agony.
Well, it's got to be agony if you're doing tricks all morning. What's this about?
A pound note.
A pound note. Most yes. kind.
I've got this off John. It was his turn to be paid. Fold it in half, and you can keep it if you manage...
Fold it in half long ways?
Yes, and put it down so that it'll stand up.
Like a little tent?
That's it. Now, if you can get this 10p coin to balance on top of it, you can keep the pound note.
It obviously is impossible. Like that, I'm supposed to.
I'll die if you do it. Oh, good, good.
Now you're going to show me
how you do it. I'll
show you how I do it. Yes, all right. Oh, that's...
Not
fair. You've got to make the rules clearer before you do these tricks.
Oh, but cheating's in it, isn't it? Well, here's a piece of string. Hold both ends. You've got to hold both ends and tie a knot in it. Right? And you've got to be able to, you can't let go of either end. You can choose how you hold
I've
it.
I've now got to tie a knot
tie
in
knot
it.
Tie a knot in it.
Wait, it doesn't... You haven't actually said that I can't have it round my...
You've got to produce a knot and still be holding both ends.
I get a feeling that if one could do this, you'd end up with no blood supply. All right. See, you're going to be unbearable after this morning. A few more of these.
You fold your arms first.
Oh, how dinky!
And then...
That's very good.
A knot.
Oh, I'm impressed with that one. Yes, I thought you were going to do something quite devious there. Is there coloured fish in it?
No, this is just a round. Very nice. Just a round.
It's just a round. More to come later?
Oh, lots more.
Dear. From Honour Oak Park in London. This has come from Angela Elliott, this being my personal letter of the week. Dear Noel, I have a budgie called Peter, but the problem with him is that he throws all his feathers out of the cage, and my mum has to hoover up nearly every day, and my mum said that she should cook him. But I would not let her. My budgie is blue, but when he gets onto the perch, he goes to sleep and he falls off again. And mum said that he's worse than a baby. Love from Angela Elliott. Aged 8. Well, Angela, I shall put this terrible dilemma to one of my special guests of this morning, Mr. Eddie Straighton. He is the consultant to the very successful BBC series All Creatures Great and Small. A chat with Eddie in a second or two, but to get us in the mood, here's a clip from that programme. Right. Would you like to pick up your telephone here? Because I hope that we have somebody on the line to ask a question about... All Creatures Great and Small. Hello, it's Line 1.
Hello.
Hello, who are you?
Chris Evans.
Hello, Chris. What's your question for Eddie Straight?
I'd like to ask him, when they do operations on the animals on the programme, do they actually do them, or you know, are the animals actually ill?
Hello, Chris. Yes, we're very, very careful on this point. Most of the small animals you see, come from my hospital, which is about 20 miles from Pebble Mill, and... When we anaesthetise an animal, it's always a genuine case. We may not be doing the operation that you actually see us doing on the screen, but we always operate on the animals if they're anaesthetized. And I do the operations. The actors just pretend to do them, and immediately after the actors are finished, then I proceed to do the operations. Many times it's a genuine case, like the dog with the pyometritis. We had to get a 12-year-old Springer Spaniel with pyometritis. And luckily enough, on the morning of the pyometritis is pus in the uterus. And the morning of the programme, of the actual filming, I had a 12-year-old Springer Spaniel brought to my surgery. And we filmed it as a sick dog. The actor, then I anaesthetised it, the actor pretended to do it, and then immediately afterwards I took the dog out into a sort of mobile studio I had outside, mobile surgery outside, and operated on the dog. And we finished the scene with the dog, after the operation, being wheeled out. It's all very authentic, that's why it comes across so well.
Right. There we go, Chris. There's the answer to your question.
Thanks very much, Noel.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Well, we'll take some calls later on in the programme, Eddie. We'll invite people to give us a ring on 018-118-055. But you brought along some...
Oh, creatures great and small.
Yes, yes. An interesting combination here. What about the larger one?
Oh, this is a ferret. It's... Hello, hello.
Now, what about ferrets and their bite?
Oh, well, if they're as tame as this one, then this is the tamest ferret I think I've ever known. It's a female. It's what we call a gill. They call female ferrets gills, and the males are called hobs. This is called Shady Lady, and it's a polecat ferret. But you feed them exactly the same as you feed dogs, on dog meat and vegetables and dog biscuits, and it's lovely, isn't it?
Well,
they're quiet only if they're reared by a certain person. Mm-hmm. If they get excited or nervous, then they can bite and give you a very, very nasty bite. They just breed once a year.
Just stay over there, if you don't mind.
You know, it's great. It's lovely.
They're very attractive. I must admit, I didn't realise a ferret could be quite so attractive. Beautiful marking.
I think they breed once a year in the spring, and the breeding season lasts for 2 months. And funnily enough, if you don't breed with a gill, they lose weight and go very, very thin.
Now, I've got a feeling quite a few young people watching will say, "Oh, Mum, I want a ferret. How practical is it to keep one?"
Well, not very practical unless you... have it just as a very small baby and rear it and handle it yourself.
And you've got to know, you've got to know a lot about it.
And you've got to know a lot about it.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's surprising. They get distemper like dogs. That's another point about it. They get mange and ringworm and all the doggy troubles.
So it's not one for just keeping sort of...
They're very, very clean animals.
For the fun of it.
If you don't keep them clean, then they get canker of the foot.
Mm.
Most of the ferrets I see are kept by poachers. and the jobs I have to do very often is to operate on the feet, because the feet get soaking wet and muddy, and the claws drop off.
Right. Well, you've lost the ferret, so now on to... what are these two?
These are rats.
Mm. Now, I thought they were rats, and...
they're Japanese hooded rats. Hello, come on.
Now, come on, Eddie, you've got to admit, the thing about rats is that you just mention that word...
Yeah.
...and it does make people curl up, so...
Well, these are wonderful. The smaller one's called Peanut, and the larger one's called Hazelnut.
And so what's so special about the... I mean, I must say, down on the farm I've got, I was confronted by a rat in the feed store, and I would never want to see another one again, because it was a huge and very ugly-looking thing. They really can be horrible, can't they?
Yeah, wild rats are, but tame rats are very, very nice pets. They're grand little things. You know, they're omnivorous. They'll eat anything. Of course, some people say they'll eat them. They're grand little
things. And a practical thing to keep?
Yes, they're very clean too, so long as you clean the cage out about once a week.
Mm-hmm.
They live till they're 5 years old. The ferrets, by the way, live to 5 years old as well.
So you're improving the image of the rat?
Yes, I was going to say Peanut is a female here, and Hazelnut. Hazelnut?
Oh, dear,
the budget. Hazelnut is a castrated male.
I think you've completely... Oh, you've got the ferret over there, great. And you brought along a couple of... I know they're budgies. Now, you're going to tell me it's an eagle.
No.
They are budgies.
They are budges, of course, yes.
I was going to say for a moment.
They came from Australia, first of all, in 1840.
Really? So they're quite old? Sorry, just a little joke.
Oh, yeah. No, they were brought into the country, first of all, in 1840 from Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And they're as easy to keep, they're as easy to feed as they are to house.
Mm-hmm.
You feed them on special grain seeds containing iodine to prevent thyroid trouble.
What about for the people who say, oh, it's cruel to keep any birds in a cage and whatever. I mean, what's your feeling as a...
Well, it's cruel to let budgerigars out of the cage outside because other birds will kill them. Mm. And I think with budgerigars, provided they have a companion, mm-hmm. I think it's not very nice to keep one on its own. They get very, very lonely. But if they have a companion, I think that it's permissible to keep them. Oh. Personally, I'd rather see them than aviary. And as I was going to say, with feeding, you've got to make sure they have plenty of grit because they've got no teeth. Mm-hmm. And the grit allows the gizzard to function properly and
to break
up
down
the food. And you've got to give them this stuff here, which is cuttlefish bone.
Right.
The idea is to keep the beaks from growing too long and also provide the mineral calcium.
Great.
But they're great.
Well, thank you very much indeed for bringing these animals along. I think the ferret is being looked after by somebody. Have we got the ferret or has it wandered off completely?
Where's Peanut?
Oh, Maggie's got the ferret.
Put Peanut back in with Hazelnut.
Right. Well, if you'd like some advice about pets, or maybe you're thinking of having a pet and you simply want to get Eddie's advice, it's 01811 8055, and he'll give you some expert advice. If you want to ask anything about all creatures, great and small, that's exactly the same number. Now... he'll be around all morning. But now we've got an odd swap film for you. There is a prize. I'll tell you about the prize in a moment. I'll give you the question in a little while. But watch this film. It's a very old film of a very brilliant comedian by the name of Will Hay. Look closely.
Huh? It's ringing now? Oh, no. No, our alarm's not ringing. Oh, I'm sorry. It's a technical glitch in our lift. Yes. We'll come along at once. We'll gallop all the way. Hey! How long's that sock been there?
Oh, ever since you had insomnia.
Well, that was last Sunday. Yeah. Well, take it out at once. No wonder there've been no fires this week.
Oh, oh, oh. There's a fire somewhere.
Of course there's a fire. There's been a fire for hours. And we should have been at it. Go on, get your helmet. Hey, who's had the hose?
You had it last, watering the garden.
Well, never mind who had it. You go and get it now, but...
Standing by, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, don't bring him in. We can't go to a fire without him.
All right, keep your wool on.
Give him a helmet.
There you are. Got both.
All this. All it.
Take it out a bit.
Right.
All right.
Memories. Where's That Fire is the title of that film, and that was Will Hay in the starring role. BBC Two are having a whole season in Will Hay at the moment, and Thursday, 6 o'clock, next Thursday, BBC Two, for some more Will Hay comedy. Now, what have I done with the prize? Here it is. This is the prize. I've got a question coming away in a moment. It's a very nice pen. I've just been writing with it, and if you press the end, can you see that it lights up, and it's also got the time. And at the moment, if I turn it around so I can read it, oh, you press it twice and you get 10:19, you press it again and it gives you the seconds as well. It's rather good, one of these clever new things they've got these days. What I want to know is how many different bells were there in that clip that you saw from Will Hay? How many different bells were there? And that's postcards, please, to the swap shop. I'll give you the address in just a moment. Do you have any idea, Posh Boys? No idea at all how many bells. Well, you're obviously not going to get the pen. It's rather a nice pen. Do like that. Also, I received a prezi from Kevin Glover from Port Carlisle in Cumbria. He's aged 4 and he sent me a breakfast. Well, he made it out of plasticine. Can you imagine eating that? For once, if you're watching in black and white, it's a definite improvement. Kevin, I'm sounding ungrateful. Thank you very much indeed. I shall give that to John Graven to eat later on. Plasticine?
Ooh, don't eat plasticine.
And then I heard from Toby Cox, who's age 5, a complaint, really, from Thornton Heath in Surrey. Please tell Poshballs not to roar. It frightens me when he roars loud. There you go, you see, you're frightening Toby. Keep it at that level, we don't want to frighten people. And Justin Bridge, who's in Dagenham Priory Comprehensive, all the time by the sound of it, he's age 13, is Justin. I thought Poshpaw's nose looked a little purple last week. Justin, it looks purple every week. Maybe he's got a cold, so I've knitted him a nose cosy. One nose cosy. Just hold still a minute. Da-da-dee. Da-da-da-da-dee-dee. Thank you very much, Justin. This is going to make life a lot simpler for everybody. Right. Go on, try roaring now. Thought so. Thank you very much, Justin. Not just keeping the nose warm, keeping him quiet. Hello, line 2. Hello?
Hello?
Hi, who are you?
Lucy Morgan from Cookham.
Good morning, Lucy from Cookham. What can I do for you?
Can I ask you a question, please?
Please, fire away.
Did you have any girlfriends before you left school?
Did I have any girlfriends before I left school?
Yes.
Well, yeah, a couple. Why? I mean, it's not the sort of thing you talk about, really, on television, is it?
What was her name?
Well, did you see last week that we were talking about the primary school I used to go to?
No.
Oh, well, we were. I'm going to mention it again this morning. I used to go out with a girl called Shirley. Well, I didn't go out with her, but I used to sit next to her on the coach going to swimming lessons. All right.
How old were you when you had her?
11. Why are you asking all these personal questions, Lucy?
I don't know. I just wanted to.
Well, you're nosy. Have you got a boyfriend?
No.
You haven't? Then
no.
You really are just a nosy Parker. Lucy Morton, down there in Cookham, mind your own business. All right?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much indeed for the call. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Right. How embarrassing, how personal. We're about to do the top 10 boards and we'll have a competition. But can I just remind you, if you want to write to Posh Paws with a nose cosy, or if you want to write to us about anything, Posh Paws has got an address. Posh Paws, we'd like to give the ladies and gentlemen the address in the way that only you can. Very good, very good. I love the way you do that. I particularly like, you know, you can't roar. The top 10 board, as I said earlier, 5 phone calls, 5 letters. Step this way and see what is on offer. Stuart is right at the top of the heap. He's offering a giant 4-foot teddy bear and he wants anything. Alistair's offering a pogo stick, wants a board game. Hello, Richard. He's offering a walkie-talkie and wants anything. Sonia, curling tongs. Mm, nice. And Perfection Game wants anything to do with Cliff Richard. Even Cliff Richard, if he's watching, I should think. Paul, acoustic guitar. And he wants rock and roll records. There's Michael, and he's offering a microscope, chemistry set, and 2 fishing reels. Wants anything to do with Porsche or exotic cars. This is getting out of hand. What's would you like, a turbo there, Michael? Miranda, Tringaling Trudy. Now, I mean, what that is, I'll leave it to your imagination. Wants a melodica. Connie, Polaroid camera, black and white. Wants a stylophone. Amanda, Doll's House, wants foreign stamps. Elizabeth, Cindy doll, and 2 outfits and wardrobe. And wants anything to do with peanuts. That's the board. The music is coming, and I'll give you a great opportunity to win the top 10 records. If you don't know what's in the top 10, keep your ears open. Here it comes.
Why can't she see? She's lovely to me. But I like to stay here and watch TV on my own every now and then. 'Cause you know. Get weary and I'm mad enough. Be like
bravest animals in the land are Captain Beaky and his band. That's Timid Toad, Reckless Rat, Artful Owl and Fatty Bat. March the woodland singing songs that tell how they have righted wrongs.
Once or twice, you come over to my place. You're screaming blue murder, needing someplace to hide.
Considered him the coward of the county. He'd never stood one single time to prove the county wrong. His mama named him Tommy, but folks just called him Yellow.
There you go, another cheerful number from Kenny Rogers sits at the top of the chart. We've got this on offer, Martian Hop from Rocky Sharp. Got Rocky Sharp LP as well. I've also got Neil Diamond's Jonathan Livingston Seagull LP, the soundtrack of the motion picture. That's on offer. I would have the top 10 records as well. Igor, have you seen the top 10 records? Oh, most kind. Thank you very much. Lovely. Your hands are looking a little softer. What's that? Oh, says he hasn't been doing the washing up, that's why. Right, there are the records that are on offer. And what I'd like to know, please, for everyone who's into gramophones and things, there are two speeds on your average gramophone, 33 and a third and 45. But at one time there used to be four speeds. And what I'd like to know is, what were the other two? Okay, 33 and a third and 45 are more common these days on gramophones. But there used to be, years ago, four speeds, and what I'd like to know is what were the other two speeds. If you could put that down on a postcard, please, send it in to this address, Swap Shop, BBC TV, London W12 8QT, to the top 10 question. And also you might care to send in your details on a postcard or a stuck-down envelope for the top 10 board, in which case it's the same address, but they are the details you have to put down. The number you're interested in, 1 to 10, what you're offering, your name, your address, and your telephone number. And now for a stunning bit of personal information. You've heard about my love life. What were you saying about what you did when you were 11?
Well, my first girlfriend was called Sandra. And I took her to the pictures when I was 11. And to my horror, the next door neighbour was sitting in the seat behind. So I didn't even speak to her the whole of the show. And Sandra got up and walked out of my life forever.
Never saw Sandra again. Funny how little things just carve your destiny. Yes. Well, your great strength has caused a lot of mail to come in. For the benefit of anybody who missed it, you tore up a telephone directory,
right,
didn't you? Well, I heard from Rachel Houghton in Luton in Bedfordshire, who said, last Saturday, John Craven tried to tear a telephone directory in half. Well, tried, he did.
He did.
She says, after some difficulty, my cousin Andrew, who's 8, can tear a telephone directory in half. Then, with a half on top of each other, he can tear it in half again and so into quarters. I wonder whether you'd like to see him do this. Well, we thought, yes, we would like to see him do it, so we've got him to come along here. Step this way, Andrew. Master Dance is here. Hello, sir.
Hello.
How are you?
Right.
Feeling strong?
Stronger than me.
Now, tell us, when did you first start doing this?
About 2 months ago.
About 2 months ago? What happened? Were you annoyed one day or something?
I was watching telly.
You were watching telly? The programme was so bad you thought, give me a telephone directory. Now, why did you start when you were watching telly?
Don't know, really.
Just felt it coming on.
I hope it was an old telephone directory, was it?
Yeah.
It was. Well, the stage is yours. It's not a particularly glamorous stage there, Andrew, but if you just like to start in your own time. Oh.
Technique of breaking the spine first of the book, isn't it?
What, the book or his?
Well, a bit of both, I think.
I hope you're getting all the facial contortions here.
A bit of showmanship going on. We should have a roll of drums or something.
It does seem to be lacking a little bit of background. Could we maybe have some oohs and ahs from the assembled technicians and things. Ooh.
Come on, Andrew, come on.
Ah. His legs come off. Ooh, is this a tough one, Andrew? Yes. We thought we'd get you with that one.
Might you give a big bang on there like I did? That might help a bit.
Ooh. Ah.
Shall we come back to it?
No.
Oh.
I'm not letting him get away with this. He's given a challenge. It's definitely coming. He is winning. I'm not letting him suffer his agony. You are doing very well at that end, Andrew.
It's a bit of the spine, isn't it? Put a bit on there, because that's metal there.
Mind the desk. Are you stuck?
Again. Give it another big one.
You're stuck. Go on, keep...
Just a second.
Television's strongest man will now assist you.
Does that help? No, I just think it does.
As the spine... Court. We ought to point out that if you do want to try this at home, first of all, you need a swap shop desk on which to bang the telephone directory.
Yes.
Only do it with an old telephone directory. And the secret is to break the spine. And obviously, we've got one here where the spine won't break.
It's nearly.
Go on, John. I would have thought you.
It's very nearly there, isn't it?
Oh, I feel sorry for you, Andrew. I mean... When you go.
Have you fixed this?
Well, I didn't want to make it look too easy. Yes. It's just a thought. We've had another phone call from Grandstand saying they are hoping to start on time.
It's that little bit there, isn't it? It's broken on one side and there's a little gap in the other one's broken.
Do you want to let me have a go? I haven't tried
yet. Yes, you have a go.
I'm enjoying it so much, I could go on all morning watching this. I've got a feeling you're going to have to do your news
almost
in a
there.
Moment.
It's there.
Go on, one last... Go on. Go on, you're not going to be beaten now. Think of the Olympics.
This is Britain Legion.
Go on. He only wanted directory inquiries. We're all willing for it. Oh, dear. This does rate amongst one of the greatest anticlimaxes ever seen on television.
He's got to tear it in quarters, then.
He's getting rather tired over there. John, I think we're going to have to
ask... That's it! That's it! It's there!
Lovely! Later that week.
Yes.
What are you doing next Saturday, Andrew? Could you come along again? Are you nearly there?
He's broken the spine.
Go on, rip that bit off. Well, look, Andrew, we'll come back to you with that. I think you're going to have to read your letters, John.
Yes.
Like...
It's through now.
A little cry from the crowd.
He let this off so we can see. You see, it's definitely...
Hello. Right, okay, jolly good. That was Brian Jacks ringing up and he just said that, if necessary, he'll rip it for you. John, your letters, please.
Fine, we'll come back to you, Andrew.
You keep going, Andrew.
Finish
go
the
on.
Letters. Right. A different kind of sport to start with, it's cricket. And we've had a letter from Peter Inman, who's 11, who lives at Erdington in Birmingham. And he says, recently England have been touring Australia, playing them and the West Indies in both Test matches and One Day matches. Towards the end of the series, I've noticed, and many others, the jeering, slow clapping and booing aimed directly at the English team. Every time the English fielders stop the ball from going to the boundary, the Aussie crowd boo. But worst of all, the crowd boo Mike Brearley, the English captain. Even in an English football match, the crowd would very rarely boo the players. I think something should be done about the spectators who watch the cricket in Australia. Well, Peter, I'm sure that the England team agree with you on that, but don't forget there's always been an awful lot of rivalry between England and Australia at cricket. And this time it's stronger because, of course, England, who hold the Ashes, the traditional prize between the two countries, refused to put the Ashes at stake this time. And there's another reason as well, that England don't want to play the rules that Australia want to play, so that added even more bitterness to the crowd's feeling. But don't forget as well, it wasn't all the crowd that were barracking Britain, it was just a small but rather noisy section of it. And now... We have two letters about school dinners. And the first one comes from Ruth Armstrong, who's 12, who lives at Eastbourne. And she says, on the 4th of February, when the price of school dinners went up, I was charged 26 pence for some ravioli on toast. When I got home that day, I did some maths. I found out that 9 pieces of ravioli, the amount we were given, would only cost roughly 9 pence, and 1 slice of toast, unbuttered, would only cost 1.5 pence. Altogether, that cost 10.5 pence. And she goes on to say, why was I charged 26 pence? I think that roast dinners, chips, etc. should cost 26 pence, but snacks, i.e. soups and sandwiches, should only cost about 16 pence. And then we have a letter from Emma Capp, who's 9, who says that we have only 84 people in our school, and most of the children are now taking sandwiches because the price is too high. And if it carries on like this, nearly all the school will not be having school dinners. Of course, the government says that for a long time it's been giving money to help keep down the cost of school meals, and it can't afford to do that anymore, and that's why the price is now going up. And finally, here's a letter from Jane Rutherford, who lives at Thatcham in Berkshire, and she says, I find it quite amazing when people go on their holidays in Spain or France, etc. Perhaps before they choose their holiday for next year, they should have a taste of English beautiful countryside. Self-catering holidays are very enjoyable, or hotels and holiday camps, if you prefer, and help us to appreciate our country and its lush green landscape and beautiful beaches. Admittedly, the weather is not predictable, but it's still worth renting a small cottage or house, which is a lot cheaper and a lot less chaotic with passports, customs, injections and luggage. Also, if you go to a foreign country, your money goes to that country's economy, which is well needed in ours. I know this is a bias towards buying British, but if everybody thought this way, Britain would be better off. Well, Jane, as somebody who's going on their holidays to France this year, you make me feel very guilty there, but it's an interesting letter, a very good talking point, and we'll make you our stringer of the week for that. And incidentally, the film report later on in the programme is all to do with a peril which at the moment is facing one of Britain's very favourite holiday spots. More about that later. Back to Noam.
Thank you very much, John. And we'll come back and find out how Andrew's getting on. But now, for all those people who like to go beyond this world, we're going to have the Battle of the Planets. Hope you enjoyed that, and now onto something which is causing me a great deal of amusement. If you were watching last week's programme, indeed the programme the week before that as well, you will have seen me hold up this photograph. It's the sort of photograph that many, many people have got tucked away. Certainly the older people watching the programme will recognise that as sort of your average school picture. But it was taken at my primary school, the Glade Primary School in Ilford. I reckon when I was about 8, I would think, I'm 31 now, so it must have been 23 years ago, and it shows the form teacher, Mr. Laws and Mr. Carter, and various people in it. In fact, everybody here, I'm there, incidentally. Yes, lovely zipped-up pullover. And lots of people don't believe that's me, but we've already started to get correspondence on the subject because I'm now searching to try and get that class back together again and find out what all those people are doing. I heard from Katie Best in Waltham Abbey, who says, you mentioned Mr. Laws, the form teacher when you were at school. He's now headmaster of the school that I have just left. And Mr. Laws dropped me a line. Good morning to you, sir. Morning, Mr. Laws. From Holy Cross Junior, Quendon Drive, Waltham Abbey in Essex. He dropped me a line with one or two nice memories. Thank you for that. I look forward to meeting him. If we can get this little meeting together, it would be rather good. From Braintree in Essex, I heard from Jackie Scott, who's Mrs. Jackie Scott, in the sense that she married Norman Scott, who is in this photograph as well. Norman wasn't watching the programme last week, but she wrote in on his behalf, so I've managed to link one other person. And Terry Eastall of the Ridings, Canvey Island in Essex. Terry says, I was in that class as well, and I can remember Alan Smith, Clive Humphreys and Clifford Godfrey. And I had someone else who spotted it on Swap Shop, Marilyn Sinclair, who used to be a Bennett, and she says, I think it was me standing right next to Mr. Carter. I didn't see the picture too well, but I've got a feeling it was. Well, I hope she's watching again. If you are, Marilyn, presumably you think that that is you over there, right next to the headmaster. One quick look at that picture. It's the Glade Primary School. I reckon we're all about eight. I reckon it's 1957-ish. If you think you know anybody in that photograph, or you might be able to help us trace the members of that form, please could you drop us a line, and I'll mention you next week. It's rather exciting for me. Help us with the quest. Can I remind you, Eddie Straighten is around all morning with answers to your questions about pets and any problems you've got with the little animals, and also if you've got any questions about all creatures great and small, Eddie is here. It's 01811 8055, also for the lovely June Whitfield, who'll be dropping him just in a little while. But right now, we've got a first. Together, simultaneous broadcast, we have Swap Shop on BBC One and the nation's number one pop station, Radio One, broadcasting together, live, at exactly the same time. It's the Peter Powell Show.
Great, thank you very much, Noel. Welcome back to Broadcasting House, home of Radio One. You're right, it is a first. It's just gone 11 o'clock and Peter's been on the air for about an hour. Peter, hello.
All right.
How's so it all far? Going?
Great.
Super.
No problem.
You're actually coming to the end of a record, aren't you?
Exactly this minute. Just hang on there, Keith. It's Dave Edmunds, and it's Hit 39, and a song called Singing the Blues. You want to hear Sarita and Billy Preston together again? You can do so. It's their brand new single. It's called It Will Come in Time.
That's can I talk right. now? Can
done.
I talk?
Yes, you can.
Yes, well, as I say, you've been on the air for about an hour. You've got 2 hours to go. Do you ever get stuck for words?
You don't get stuck for words, no, because if I did, I wouldn't be doing the job. Sometimes you feel a bit dry in the mouth, and so you sort of wet it with coffee, and it keeps you going. But you don't get stuck for words, because everything comes from the front of your head. You have about 3 minutes average duration between one record finishing and the next beginning, and in that 3 minutes, you use your time to think a little bit about what you're going to say
right.
and how you're going to say it, and take it from there.
Being a DJ, I think, is not the easiest thing in the world. I mean, you've got all this equipment down here. It's like driving a car and trying to do the washing up at the same time.
Bit,
yes,
yeah.
When I've done it, though, I usually get dirty plates and the brakes don't work.
Well, if I make a mistake... If you look at it like a car or an airline, like an aeroplane, if you make a mistake... So with this, if you make a mistake, you go off the air.
I've got
or a record goes the wrong speed. So you try very hard to think technically as to how the programme's going to go out. Would you like me to explain?
Yes, please do. Please.
I think we've got
some time.
We've got a couple of minutes, I think.
Super.
We have what we call the faders. Different colours. These three here are for the cassette machines, 1, 2, and 3.
Right.
And I'll explain a cassette a little bit later on. Mm. Two microphones, one for myself, the master microphone, and that's there for yours there. We've got the three tapes, which are actually operated in the other room, in the control room, but it's the balance is still done from here, and right. I can start the tape, but they set it all up.
So, for example, when Tony Blackburn gets tape requests into the show, he sort of cues them in from here or
they're
starts
done.
To play them from here?
He plays them from here, but they're put on in the control room.
I see. What
room.
Do the last three do there?
Those are the decks, the most important controls.
Mm.
1, 2, 3 decks, and systematically 1, 2, and 3. As you can see, this fader is the only one up on the panel, and that means that the only output at the moment going out on the station is on this deck, which is Billy Preston and Sarita, which is going out. The rest of the deck is all dead. When I turn the microphone on, I put this up,
right.
and a red light, which I don't know if the cameras can see, possibly not, but a red light shines, and all sound, yeah, that's right, and all sound in the studio is killed instantly. Therefore, there's nothing going around except what I can hear in my headphones.
Right.
Only got 30
You've
seconds.
You've got to set up another record, haven't you?
I've got to set up the next record. Just hang on there.
This is the complicated bit, really, isn't it?
It depends. Sometimes, when we're on the road, doing a road show, all the excitement is happening all like now, and you only have about 15 seconds to cue, and then it's a bit of a panic. But
what are we going to hear
up
next,
and now
then?
Ready to go.
What are we going to hear?
I think you're going to introduce it.
Oh.
Yeah, go on, why not?
Like what, live on Radio 1?
Yeah, if
that'd be super, yeah.
If I circle it there.
Yes.
It's that one just there.
I knew you'd get me doing something like this, you know.
You've got to do it live.
I shall move my coffee.
Right, you're on the air in just a minute. Here you
okay.
go.
There you go, smashing record that, and it's a great good morning from me, Keith Chagrin, who's popped into the Peter Powell Show here on Radio 1, and I've got the job of queuing up the next record, would you believe, and hopefully I'm not going to make a mess of it. It's The Tourist, and it's so good to be back home again.
Yeah, yeah, all done.
I don't believe I'll great. Kill you for that.
That is it.
Yeah, you said to me a minute ago you're going to explain some of the jingles you've got here at Radio 1. Is it possible to hear some of the favourite ones we hear
yes, it
on
is.
The radio?
Let me just pop that one away.
Okay.
In the box down there.
You really did...
Let's take out 1, 2, 3.
Right.
I'm just shoving it in the machine. Get that there. Actually, what I'll do is just explain the cartridge, the jingle.
Yes.
That's slang. There's a certain amount of radio slang, like queuing is when you turn a record to cue it up to start properly.
I've got
cans are headphones.
Yes.
And a jingle is actually a cartridge, rather like an 8-track, except it's a continuous loop of tape. And it's got a magnetic stop on it. So when I put it in the machine like that, I'll play on pre-fade. This will not be going out on the radio.
I see.
OK, I'm now playing it into the studio, just for my own benefit, so I can listen to the jingle or listen to a promo, for instance, that's been done for the network. And it sounds something like this.
Smile with us in the morning, here on Radio 1.
That's one of my favourite jingles.
Do you like that one?
What other ones have you got on?
Got the weather check. Actually, I have got the weather, in fact. I can explain very briefly how we do this.
Mm.
The weather check jingle is used, obviously, to ident the weather. So,
Radio 1 weather check.
And then there's lots of backing music. So I go, Northern and Eastern Scotland and North East England will start dry and sunny. I won't do it now because I'll be doing it live in about an hour. So I'll keep that for later.
Right. Where do you get information like that, Peter?
Weather and traffic news both come from little departments hidden up on other floors. And men run down with their bits of carbon paper and we sit there and say, oh, yes, that's the latest weather, or a very urgent motoring flash comes down.
So as soon as it gets in here, it's in here and it goes out live on the air.
And they are actually, they are helped by the AA and the police, so it's all very spontaneous. And they can have it 1 minute and we can have it the next and the news can be out. I'll just kill that one.
Time to cue up another record using radio slang.
Cue.
Super.
Right,
great. Is it? Should I keep quiet?
No, you carry on talking.
Okay.
Because I can listen to my headphones.
How long have you been here at Radio 1 now?
November 1977.
Damn it, that's just over 3 years, really.
It's quite a long time.
Yes, how did you join Radio 1?
I joined Radio 1 from... Oh, we're coming up.
Oh.
So that's that, indeed, from one tourist band. And so good to be back home. And Keith Chegwin, that was most magnificently done, Keith.
Thank you very much.
I might add. To everyone at home, it's 7 minutes past 11 o'clock on Radio 1. And I think the best thing we can do now is to play a brand new smash record to be.
Great.
From a gentleman none other than Cliff Richard. And the song is called Carrie.
Sorry to disturb you, but I was in the neighborhood about a friend I've heard that you could you take a look? Oh, I appreciate you're busy and time's not your own. Yeah, maybe it would be better if I tell you.
Carry us to room on
and his new hit single called Carrie, and that was going out simultaneously on Radio 1 and on Swap Shop, and we saw the video, and of course that's where the sound was coming from as well.
That is
not
super.
Bad, eh?
That smashing piece. Good. I thoroughly enjoyed that.
Sorry, I forgot to put your microphone up, Benke. Stop now.
And actually, we've got Noel with us. Hello, Noel.
Hello, good morning.
Hello. Noel. Is this the place where you do your radio show from?
No, I think that's C, isn't it, Peter?
You're in
C. No, directly behind Peter, where we saw Tony earlier, is where my Sunday show comes from B.
And you shall be there tomorrow morning, I expect?
Yes, 10 till 1. I shall be in there with tin helmets and coffee and whatever.
Hey, no.
I've nicked it.
Now, for the benefit...
Put it on head.
People keep saying to me, there is no such thing as a Radio 1 tin helmet. Right. Well, that's the one that's standard issue, kept in the studio.
It's got a nice ring to it, hasn't it?
Lean forward, lean forward. Shall I knight him now, Noel?
Please. What's that? A mallet would have been better.
I've become a fully-fledged Radio 1 ringer.
Yeah.
We'll see you a bit later on, eh, Noel?
OK, thank you
very much indeed.
Thank you, gentlemen. How about that for a you're doing it again, for a one-off. Come over to the graffiti board as we continue with the TV while Radio 1 continues. 275-285. Thank you very much indeed for all the bits and pieces you've been sending in to the graffiti board. I do like this one up here. Just try and get in on that. A horrible needlework teacher is a right old so-and-so. Very good. My brother likes to suck his thumb. Mm-hmm. Our cat scratches, yes. To the mods who got on the 529 bus on Friday the 4th of January... lots of love and happy Valentine's Day from you-know-who. Don't forget February the 22nd. I think that one ties in with a message that we had meters in Woolies. There's obviously something going on with the mods there. Homework rattles the brain. Well, look, if you've got any ideas... Angela loves Bob Geldof. Well, I've no doubt she does. If you've got any ideas for a bit of graffiti, if you feel that you would like a mention on the graffiti board, then all you've got to do is send the information in. And talking of things that have been sent in, look at this lot.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Newspaper competition.
That's right. We've had hundreds and hundreds of entries into the Swap Shop local newspaper competition, and today's the day that we announce the winners. It seems that they fell into two separate categories, really. There were sort of school newspapers, official ones and rather jokey ones that sent up the teachers, isn't it? And then also the local newspapers, a village or street or area newspaper as well. So we're going to have two prizes.
Mm-hmm.
And in the first section, the sort of school newspaper, this one really stood out. Have a look at that, Maggie. What do you think of that?
Oh, that's amazing, isn't it?
The Greenwood Garbage. It's Greenwood Academy's unofficial school magazine.
This is following an investigation on school meals after a tooth was found in a pork sausage. You know which school she goes to?
I think that's a joke. But just look through it. I mean, it's beautifully laid out, all with felt tips. It's all felt tips. Marvellous colour schemes.
Wasn't your tooth in there,
wasn't it? No, hang on, Mr. Really exciting and interesting to look at. It's written by...
It's
the work of Fiona Gibson, who's 15. And I don't think Fiona will have any difficulty at all in getting a job on a newspaper or magazine when she leaves school if she wants to.
The artistic side is beautiful,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Can we just see that cover again? I love the way she's... You see the way that she's actually coloured in all round here.
Yeah.
It actually makes the title seem to stand off the paper.
Yeah. It's very well done.
That is smashing, I think.
Very,
so
very
that's,
good.
That's one of our winners,
mm-hmm.
Fiona.
That's the school magazine.
That's the school magazine section. And we got a lot of entries in the local magazines. Here's a short... list, if you'd like to look at a couple of those.
Spotlight, the monthly newspaper about the Buxton Opera House.
Yes, that's a sort of specialist paper.
It's come in from Peter Willis. Buxton in Derbyshire, yeah. And he's typed it all out on the front there. Looks very professional.
Very nicely laid out. And at the back, they explain...
It's got pictures as well.
Yes, lots of pictures. Although he says that it's issue number 4, and he refers to articles in previous editions, at the end, he admits that, in fact, it's the very first edition. And he's done it to enter the competition, but he wanted to make it look as though it was an official, well-established newspaper, you see. So he calls it number 4 instead of number 1.
He's got Roy Castle in there, even with a message to Peter.
There's a Brighton Star that you've got.
Nicola Moorcroft.
Oh, I do like this one. It's very
Sports
posh.
Review, isn't it?
Posh.
An awful lot of work has gone into these.
I see one with houses for sale?
Yes, that's right.
Oh.
A lot of them have got ads.
Loads.
I don't know how official many of these ads are, whether they've actually
Angela Haynes.
Been paid for them.
Lockerbie News.
But we looked through every one. We looked through every one of these papers in the office, and what we were really looking for in a newspaper was, you know, lots of good local news and information, well laid out, something that really looked like a newspaper.
Uh-huh.
And... I must admit that everybody seems to have followed the advice I gave in the swap shop book about how to lay out your local paper, and almost with that exception, they're all much better than the Grimthorpe Street Gazette, which was the one I did when I was about 11. And I think that it was left to me from the newsround team to pick the winner, and I think this is very good. It's the Tideswell Echo. It's from the village of Tideswell in Derbyshire, and it's the work of Julie Shirt, who's 13. And it's exactly what you want a local amateur paper to be. It's interesting news stories, it's got well-laid-out sections and headlines, it's got jokes, adverts, recipes, children's corner, the top 10, and of course on the back page there's sport, with all the local sport, including the Tideswell League darts.
Fun jog as well.
A fun jog. I think that's a really good effort. And it's obviously all Julie's own work. She's written it herself and she's arranged the headlines. And there's a story here that might interest you, Noel. It's Mr. Ken Gibson celebrated the completion of his milking parlour. The cubicle house is capable of housing 90 cows. The shed has been built where solid rock once stood. The rock had to be blown up using dynamite before building could begin. And there's a drawing of it.
Right.
So I think, don't you? Do you agree?
Excellent stuff.
That
yes.
Julie Shirt, who's 13, is our second winner with her Tideswell Echo. And both Julie and Fiona will be invited to Newsround as their prize to spend a day with us on Newsround to see how we put our newspaper of the air together.
Jolly good. Where were the fellas? Well done, ladies.
Yes, a lot of boys, but not in the winners.
Question time!
Thanks, everybody, for competing.
What is that?
Ah, oh. It's a swap shop award.
It's a swap shop award.
It's an Eric.
It's an Eric.
26, would you care to hold on to that for the moment? Page 26, the current Radio Times. That's the one with Robin Cousins on the front of it. I pointed it out to you last week on the programme. This has got our swap shop special award coupon in it. And what we've done is we put it down on a postcard here. It does help us an awful lot if you can cut it out of the Radio Times and mount it on a postcard. And if you look at that, you can see the way in which we would ideally like you to send in your votes for the Swap Shop Television Awards. We're looking for favourite pop star, for funniest man, funniest lady, for the favourite pop group, the top sportsman, top sportswoman, children's TV star, children's TV programme, an expert. And there are a lot of people for that category. You might think of Dr. Magnus Pike, or have you got any experts you think of?
I know a lot of people find it quite difficult to think of an expert.
Well, it's Attenborough, yeah. David Attenborough, who came on the programme.
Yeah.
It's
anybody with a specialist television
yes.
programme.
Yes,
it's not necessarily scientific.
No,
it can be. Yeah.
It could be the lady who trains the dogs.
And the important thing to mention, of course, is that it can be somebody from the other channel if you want. We're not. Oh, yes,
really?
there is another channel. And the voting is only open to anybody under the age of 16. It's a very young poll we're looking for, and you cannot vote for any of the regular presenters of Swap Shop. So you can't vote for me or for John or for Maggie or for Keith or Delia. But please, you can vote for anybody else. And if you'd like a bit of a refresher as to what happened last year, here we have a clip from the awards ceremony for 1979. Sonia Lanneman received her Eric for Top Sportswoman. Marty Kane was the funniest lady. She got hers from Richard Baker. Children's television personality was Tony Hart. Swap Shop's favourite pop star was Debbie Harry from Blondie. She accepted her Eric from actor Christopher Timothy, who dropped in from All Creatures Great and Small. Got a kiss. And then came the Funniest Man Award, and it went to that man, Michael Crawford. Neris Hughes was there to present it to him. And we'll be presenting the awards programme on April the 6th.
Easter right. Sunday.
Is that Easter Sunday?
I think it is.
April the 6th,
yeah.
Right. Jolly good. Okay.
Right.
Followed all that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Are you allowed to vote?
Nope.
You could vote. No, you're over 16.
Just over 16, actually.
Right. It's your news story now.
Oh, it's not, is it?
Yes, and
it's
you're not. In the wrong place.
I haven't got my script.
Well, it'll be over there, won't it?
Well, I don't know. Oh, hang on. Oh.
I'm sure it is your news story.
Is it?
Yes.
No. I haven't got my script. Oh dear. Ill prepared today I was. No, not that script, Tony.
Right then.
Can you do the next thing and I'll come back to it?
Well, I would have thought...
Is that possible?
I would have thought it was quite possible to go to the top 10 board right now. Would you think that was a distinct possibility? For all those people who would like to catch up on the top 10 board, we'd be grateful if you would, because it would get us out of a little bit of a jam. The Reprise is a beautiful piece of music. See if you can guess what it is. It accompanies some excellent hang gliding, a dangerous sport, but an exhilarating one. Have a look at the top 10 board and listen to some beautiful sounds.
Songbird, make your tune, or none may sing it just as you do. And make your song be heard. Caught on the wind's lazy tide, sweetly how it sings. Rally each heart at the sight of your silver wings. Skybird, skybird. Nightbird, find your way. None may know it just as you may. Seek out your harbor of light. Let your song be heard. Rally each heart to the sight of your silver wings.
Neil Diamond doing his thing, of course. Beautiful music. I love that hang gliding. I'd never like to have a go. It's too dangerous. But now we have the number one question on Swap Shop for this Saturday morning. Guess what's next?
Really?
Got it in one.
Yes, it's the film report. At last. And this week, it's about the danger that's threatening miles and miles of coastline in the south of England. The threat comes from canisters that are being washed ashore from a shipwreck, because some of those canisters contain deadly chemicals. So far, nobody has been seriously hurt, but the warning has gone out not to touch any of them, and the massive job is underway of patrolling the beaches and hunting for the canisters. The X on this map shows the spot where the ship, the Aeolian Sky, went down, and the cargo is coming ashore along the coast of Dorset and Hampshire and on the Isle of Wight. So far, well over 1,000 of these canisters have been washed up on the island, and more than a dozen contained deadly chemicals. I went to the south coast yesterday to investigate.
These are the cliffs and lovely beaches of the Isle of Wight, a favourite holiday spot for many families. During the winter, though, things are quiet on the island, but not this winter, thanks to a ship called the Aeolian Sky. This rocky outlet is the Needles, the island's most famous landmark, and it was out in the English Channel, in a straight line from here, that the Aeolian Sky went down. She was a Greek cargo boat, and 3 months ago, she was in collision with another ship and sank. She was just another shipwreck until the news broke that £2 million in foreign banknotes had mysteriously disappeared before divers went down to check her. Well, that was a big story, but an even bigger one was to follow, because what nobody knew was that the Aeolian Sky had been carrying a dangerous cargo. The first warning came when canisters began to turn up on the beaches brought in by the tides. Firemen wearing special safety suits got the job of checking the canisters, and they've been doing it ever since. Before anyone realised the danger, 7 people were taken to hospital after being overcome by fumes from the canister. And this whale was washed ashore dead, making a total of 3 in the last week. Tests are now being carried out to see if they were poisoned by the chemicals. The fire brigade are called out every time someone spots a suspect canister. Often, they turn out to be harmless, but the firemen can't take any chances.
Well, what's happening here this morning is a genuine emergency. The Coast Guard cutter over there picked up a suspect canister floating out at sea and brought it into the harbour here and called the fire brigade. And now the firemen are putting on their special protective uniforms before they go anywhere near the canister to investigate it.
Inside these spaceman-like suits, the men are sealed off from danger. They've got their own air supply so they don't breathe in fumes, and their bodies are completely protected if the chemicals should spill. And while they were getting ready, I got more details from the skipper.
Where did you find the canister then?
We found it just off the Scotch Bore there, just a Hurst Point there.
But floating on the sea?
Yeah.
So what did you do?
Got a rope round it and just heaved it inboard.
Did you think it might be from the air and sky?
Yeah.
So you weren't taking any chances?
Yeah.
You didn't touch it or anything?
No, just with a rope.
Now comes the job of lifting the canister ashore and trying to find out a bit more about it. The amazing thing is that nobody knows for sure what the Aeolian Sky was carrying when she sank. Now, this could have been part of her cargo, or it could have been dumped by any of the hundreds of ships that sail through the English Channel every day. But this canister obviously isn't harmless. The men decide to take it straight away to their chemical-proof truck that's waiting close by.
Roger, what was it then, I think?
I think it's sodium hydroxide. It's used for boiler cleaning. The can was 1/3 full when we got it off the boat.
And so it could be dangerous then?
It could be, yes. Yeah.
Then the convoy moves off in a procession which during the past few weeks has become a familiar sight to the people of the Isle of Wight. Some of them think the army and the navy should be called in to help the firemen and that the government should pay towards the cost of the cleanup. This convoy's destination is a safe area about a dozen miles away where a special shed has been built to store and guard all the dangerous canisters. Later, this one will be carefully checked to try to discover whether it did come from the sunken ship. These are just some of the poisonous or harmful containers that the firemen have picked up in the past few weeks. And this one, so deadly that it can only be handled in a protective suit, contains arsenic trichloride. Nearly a dozen of these have been washed up so far, and I was told that just one sniff of this chemical could lead to death.
Well, what is really worrying the officials now is that it'll soon be half-term holiday, and especially if the weather's fine, there could be lots of people wandering along the shorelines of the south coast. And the last thing anybody should do if they spot a suspicious-looking canister like this one is to touch it. Now, what they should do is try and remember exactly where they've seen it, and if possible, mark it with, say, a large piece of driftwood like this, and then immediately tell the police. So far, nobody has died, but that doesn't mean the danger from these canisters is over. For it's certain that in the next few weeks and months, much more of the Aeolian Sky's deadly cargo will be washed in from the sea.
Well, next week a government minister will be going to the area to see the problems for himself, and the firemen told me that no matter what happens, they'll do everything they can to make sure that the beaches are safe before the holiday season begins at Easter. No.
Thank you very much, John. And now, a little question for you. Do you know what that is? Any ideas what
it's
that
is? It's an egg, isn't it?
It is an egg.
Yes.
Very good, it is an egg. Would you know from what particular
good
creature?
An ostrich or something like
an
that?
An ostrich egg?
An
well,
ostrich?
It isn't an ostrich egg, but... No. It wasn't a bad shot.
No.
I must admit, I wouldn't have known about that egg.
No.
But I've no doubt that my guest Eddie Straighten would know all about it. Dominic just brought this in to me this morning. One egg. Feels quite fresh. It's all wobbly.
Gee.
Just a bit of sticky tape on there.
I was looking to see if the name was on there.
No, cheating.
It must be a very, very big bird.
I would hope so.
Yes, it's got to be an ostrich or something like that.
It's a goose egg.
I was going to say it might be a big goose.
Yes. I've got new respect for geese now.
So have I. Yes.
Make your eyes water, wouldn't it?
Yes. Or, you know, I was thinking in terms of a very, very big goose or turkey, but
still. Goose egg. First one, actually.
It's the biggest one I've ever seen. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dominic. I better put that somewhere safe. On the subject of the budgies, it was a funny little letter that I got before about budgie losing feathers. And whatever, but I mean, you do read these stories, how they peck themselves and fall off perches and things.
Oh, yeah, yes, I heard you reading that out. And when they're pecking themselves, this is a sign that they're bored.
Mm-hmm.
And also that perhaps the diet's not right. I should have mentioned that in addition to the grit and the seed there and the cuttlefish bone, they should have green stuff every day.
Mm-hmm.
So when they're pecking the feathers out like that little girl's budgie, they should get a mate for.
And what about this falling off the perch thing? I mean, it seems quite funny, but it's probably not funny for the budgie.
Well, this is very often caused by fumes in the room. Usually some brain damage, either from poisoning or possibly a vitamin B deficiency.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's falling off the perch, then the veterinary surgeon really ought to be called in.
Lots of us are fortunate enough to live in centrally heated houses. Is the temperature in a room vital?
Temperature's vital for budgerigars. They should have room temperature. 15 to 20 degrees centigrade is about the correct temperature.
So keep them away from directly above a radiator?
Well, you've got to keep them away from direct sunlight. You've got to keep them away from damp or draft, and you mustn't cover the cage at night. So many people cover the cage at night, but when you do that, you just interfere with the ventilation.
Mm.
It's not necessary if you switch the light off.
Right.
And another interesting thing, you know, the best talkers are the males.
Yeah.
The females don't talk very well.
Mm. Okay, well, that's the subject of budgies. Eddie, to the phone again, please. And let's find out what sort of question we've got on line one. Hello, line one.
Hello.
Hello, who are you?
Samantha Molyneux.
Hello, Samantha. Welcome to the programme. Eddie's here. What's your question?
I want to ask, if you want a rat or a ferret, how can you choose one that won't bite?
Stick your finger in the cage.
Yeah, well, I think you're in great difficulty in choosing one that won't bite because they tend to bite strangers. But what I would suggest is you go to someone like the owner of the ferret we had today, who has reared it to be so quiet, as almost unbelievably quiet, and get a ferret from a person like that. This is the best advice. The rat is easier to train. All these tiny creatures respond to kindness and quiet voice. You must never shout at them. You must feed them yourself and keep them in a quiet part of the house. Keep them well away from your mother's vacuum cleaner. The sudden noise of a vacuum cleaner will upset a rodent or a mouse. So, you know,
surprise.
It's just kindness and gentle handling and the rat will live about you.
Yeah.
There we go, Samantha.
Thank you, Samantha.
Thank you for your question.
Right, bye.
Bye. Line four. Four.
Hello?
Hello, who are you?
Karen.
Hello, Karen. Right, what's your question for Eddie?
Eddie, what's been your most distressful moment on TV?
Ooh, your most distressing moment?
On TV?
You pessimist, Karen.
My first television programme in 1957 on the farming programme. I was all geared up, and just before we went on, John Sherrington, who was introducing the programme, said to me, he said, "Are you scared?" I said, "No, I'm terrified." And we went on. I was supposed to be doing a live commentary on a silent film. We had no telecine in Birmingham. The telecine was coming from London, and I had never seen the film. Naturally, I was all geared up, and I got started on this film, and after 3 minutes, the film broke down.
Ah.
And John Sherrington and I had to carry on for about 12 and a half minutes, improvising and talking, and that just terrified me.
Is that when your hair turned grey?
Yeah, that's when it came off at the back.
Okay, there's the answer to your question. Thank you.
Now,
yes.
Could you give a quick wave to my mum and dad?
Yeah, certainly. They are.
Just can I wave too?
There you go, yes. Double wave. And line five.
Hello?
Hello, who's this?
Claire Williams.
Claire, you're through to Eddie Straighten.
Good morning, Eddie.
Good morning, Claire.
We've got two young cats. And they sleep on a white blanket on our chair. And lately it's been getting a bit grubby. So we wondered if we'd be able to bath them, because we've heard that if you bath cats, they won't wash themselves again. Is this true?
No, it's not true. You can bath cats, but it's not an easy job. When you're bathing the cat, you get some of your mummy's squeezy and put it in some hot water. And also get someone who's used to handling cats to hold the cat, because it will struggle. But it doesn't prevent them cleaning themselves and licking themselves afterwards. I think we have to bath cats when they've got bad skin diseases, and we always have difficulty in doing so. And you know, usually I have a trained animal nurse to hold them and another trained animal nurse to wash them. So it's not easy. I would say far better to brush and comb the cat and change the blanket. Otherwise you're going to get some fleas in that blanket, and it can be very difficult to get rid of.
And also they've got a habit of licking a dog's face. And washing the fur on the dog's face.
Well, I think this is rather nice. I really do. It's great when a cat teams up with a dog. There's nothing nicer. We have nine cats in my hospital, and several dogs, and all our cats will go to a dog and attempt to lick them. It's just great.
Can I give away to my mum? She's lying on the
bed watching the portable
telly.
Can I wave to
your
mum?
Yes, please.
No, mum.
OK, thank you very much for your call. Bye. That's all we've got time for on the telephone, but one very quick one on the letter. And I heard from Darren Bryan, who's in Newport. It's a story about a goldfish, a miracle goldfish, because it was living the day after they put it in the bowl, because they seem to lose a lot of goldfish. It is true, actually. I mean, goldfish are sort of given away at fetes and fairs and things, and they do seem to suffer an awful lot.
You see, what happens, they usually keep them in a bowl with a very small opening at the top, and they're dependent for their survival on oxygen.
It's in fact the standard, what we call a goldfish bowl, is a terrible
design.
It's all wrong.
You must have as much surface area as possible to absorb the oxygen.
Yeah.
And without the oxygen, the fish will die. Yeah. But you usually find that these goldfish have been handled too much, too.
Right.
Although I remember one old creatures program we had a goldfish that had to jump out of the bowl, and we rehearsed this, and the goldfish jumped out of the bowl 3 times during rehearsal, and twice during the take, and still survived beautifully. But it was in a lovely big tank with a wide open top. Yes.
OK, Eddie, on to your swap, please. What have you brought along for us this week?
Well, this is the first of my own memoirs, with a foreword by James Herriot. This is coming out in paperback in July, but we've changed the title and we've changed the front. There's a cartoon of me being chased in the by a bull in the front of the paperback, and they're going to call it Vet in Charge. So that, and then I've got a special swap. I had a special swap.
I think it was removed.
Oh, a lovely hunting crop. Who's got my hunting crop?
A hunting crop. Have we got the hunting crop?
It's a very special hunting crop.
Tell us the
story.
Here we are. Tell us the story about it.
Well, not only was it used by Siegfried in the All Creatures Great and Small scenes where he's riding his horses, but this hunting crop is 150 years old, and it's got a special silver top. That is pure silver with a hallmark.
Yes.
I should have polished it, but you know.
It was actually used in the series.
Yes, it's been used in the series.
Terrific.
That's great. But I've also got a special present for you.
Oh.
Well,
oh,
I did.
Crazy time.
Yeah, well, I did hear that your very fertile cow, Ermentrude, is going to have another cow.
At about the 15th attempt, yes.
And I thought this will make you a really top class maternity nurse. you can read it to Ermentrude.
Well, it's due in July, so I'll let you know how it goes.
Due in July.
All right, well, that is marvellous. Thank you very much.
Of my calving book and
Thank you very much indeed. I need a question for. That's great.
Yeah. Your question? I want to know the breed, the pet name, and the pedigree name of this year's Croft champion.
Simple as that. Postcards, please, on that. Postcards for Eddie Straight and Swap. Eddie, thank you once again for coming along. If Ermentrude is troublesome, I'll phone you right away.
You give me a ring, yes.
And now a change, a contrast for you, away from the subject of animals, and move on to music. And here come once again Rocky Sharp and the Replays.
Thank you.
We have just discovered an important note from space. The Martians plan to throw a dance for all our human race. So I was surprised to see the Martians twist and stop before my very eyes. They did the locomotion and the hully-gully too. I couldn't name a single dance the Martians couldn't do. Just begun. The Earth keeps progress, spaceships down.
There we go with Rocky Sharp and the Replays. More music in a moment when we'll go back live with Radio 1. Andrew, our telephone terror, has done it. And he did that. You did that without assistance, didn't you?
Yeah.
Show us the two halves. And if anyone's eagle-eyed, just show the binding on the back to that camera that's got the light on it there, Andrew. You'll see that what fooled him was they've got a plastic strip in the back of the telephone directories. And before, they used to be sort of glued, and it was a little bit easier, so you can't beat plastic. Andrew, strong lad. Are you going to take Brian Jackson on at dips and that sort of thing? See you on Superstars. No? You've lost your voice now, haven't you, from doing that? Thank you for doing that for us.
Well, John's
Maggie.
Not been the same since he had a go this morning.
No, John has a wheelchair most of the week. No.
Actually, I bet you can't separate my hands like that, can you?
I can't separate your hands?
No.
You're quite right. Stupid girl. Agnes, could you turn the machines on, please? If Agnes could turn on the swapperettes. All right, Agnes! Top 10 question in here. Pull out one of the correct cards. The question last week, where is the largest reflector telescope in Great Britain situated? The answer was the Royal Greenwich Observatory, Hurstmonceux in East Sussex. Name and address, please.
Keith Hammond, Wentworth Road, Overslade Estate, Rugby.
Well done, Keith. You win the top 10 records, as per there. Here we've got the odd swap. The question last week, how many dogs jumped over the hurdle in the film that we showed you? The answer was simply one. There was only one dog that actually jumped over the hurdle. This stunningly beautiful dog is a surprise.
Emma Cropper, Parkhurst Road, Prenton, Birkenhead, Merseyside.
Well done, Emma. Put that one there. Moving on to Marty Webb. And what is the American name for an ice lolly, was Marty's question. The answer, of course, a popsicle.
Robert Weir, Bent Crescent, Fallside, Uddington, Scotland.
Jolly good. And Evita book, Marty Webb's LP, Tell Me on a Sunday, and also an American recording of Evita. And finally, David Bellamy, what is the name of the plant that he brought along? That was the plant. It's an absolutely amazing thing. It really is incredible. It's almost like it's in pottery, but it was a plant. It's a cone or the fruiting head of a Banksia.
And Andrew Forsdyke got that right. From Tansdale Farm, Rawcliffe, it looks like, Preston, Lancashire.
Thank you, Maggie. Well done, Andrew. You get a microscope and then you get all the necessary bits and pieces to go with it so that you can spend hours staring with just one eye. And now, back, it's only just down the road, straight down Marylebone Road, and it's back to Broadcasting House.
And here we are. Welcome back to the happy sound of Radio 1, 275 and 285, where Peter's doing his show live at the moment. Peter was saying a minute ago that, or a while ago, that he's been here for 3 years now, but the latest offering here at Radio 1 to the DJ scene is a chap who shows between 7.30 and 10 o'clock tonight. Hello, good morning, Steve Rice.
Hi, Keith.
Hi, Steve. How are you enjoying life here at Radio 1?
I'm loving it. It's great. I've been here 5 weeks, and I'm loving every moment of it, Keith.
What were you doing before, Steve?
Well, I've been working in commercial radio, on local commercial radio, for 3 years, and after that I was working at Radio Luxembourg for a while.
I see. Well, what's he doing here this morning? I know he shows at 7:30
Well, I saw you
tonight.
On the telly this morning, and I thought, I'm not going to miss out. All the engineers here are now stars. So I thought, well, I'll come in and go on myself.
But seriously,
I've always wanted to be on the Swap Shop. Now I've come in to prepare the show
I see.
Tonight.
And you've actually come in to do a trailer for tonight's programme,
yeah,
haven't you, with Peter?
A little trailer.
Is it about ready?
Just think about you, Steve.
Okay.
Okay. Styx from the LP Cornerstone. And why me? Why Steve Jones in the studio? That's all I want to know, Stevie.
You were close. Steve Wright, yes. Hello.
It's live.
It's havoc here, I tell you. It's live radio. Listen, tonight, 7.30, we've got some good things on the show tonight. We've got these lateral thinkers. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've heard those that we're doing, to tease your brain.
That's very live flat, I presume.
Yeah, all that kind of stuff. Yeah. And also, we've got a live session from Bill Haley and the Comets. And we've got the movie news and the tour news and lots of other things. It's all tonight, 7.30 until 10.
Steve Wright, 7.30 until 10. So that's why Steve's in the studio, you see, Keith.
Super.
He's doing a promo with us, obviously. And as the network goes through the day, we obviously advertise, basically, each other's programmes as best we can. And especially if people have got particular features on, it's important to do that. And we have a system of trailers. I've got one here, actually, right, which I'll play in a short while, which is someone goes into a studio and makes a trailer for it. Or alternatively, the DJs can come in live and do it like
Super.
That, like Steve has.
But I suppose more music is the order of the day, isn't it?
I think so. Do you want to hear a bit?
I'd love to.
All right. It's 14 minutes to 12 o'clock on Radio 1 and Swap Shop simultaneously. Here's Donna Summer and on the radio.
Super. That's a good title to combine with what we're doing, actually. You mentioned you've got an awful lot of things in your show tonight. How much preparation do you do before you go on the air, Steve?
Well, I usually sit down with Ted Beston, who's the producer of the show, sort of midweek, like we sit and listen to all the new records, see what's around,
dig out a few oldies, dig out a few nice LP tracks. And I'd sort of scan the papers during the week, look for funnies, you know, listen out to what people are saying, see if anything's going on, anything big going on, you know, like there's this the Viking exhibition at the moment, and all sorts of concerts and things. And so, I mean, really, all week I'm preparing, you know.
Yes, that's right. Just out of interest, Peter, when you're going out live on the air, do you play to an audience? What do you have in your mind? Who's there?
In the early days, yeah. When I first started in radio, I used to take my jacket off and put it on my chair behind me now. I used to put it on a chair in front. And I used to hang a little sign underneath which said smile. And I used to play to my jacket and smile at the same time, which brings out a sort of bright and breezy attitude in the voice. But now I put the jacket back on, I take the sign off, and I try to communicate to one person. But at the same time, if you're broadcasting to a family of five or six, then you've got to obviously communicate with all of them individually. Right. But if you do it with one person...
Do you ever get up in the morning and think, oh, I feel terrible, I don't feel like going on?
No streaming headache.
Yes. I've heard you on the radio with a cold, actually.
I think every disc jockey in the country has done a radio show with a cold. But it's not our prerogative to be down. We're the ones who've got to be up, because there may be 20,000 people listening to the radio who've also got a cold, and they don't want to know about my problems, so it's my responsibility to get over it and not to show it.
Yes. Have you had any embarrassing moments?
Well, technically, there's always embarrassing moments when perhaps you hit a stop button on a record which is actually going out live and it goes blah, 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 like that. I won't do it now because it would wreck the radio show. I don't know about you, I get quite excited, and we've got these new chairs which squeak quite a lot, and they all swing back, and only about 2 weeks ago I was bouncing on the chair and I went, that was it, and off you get in the middle of a sentence.
That's true. All right, Peter, well, with that, can I thank you very much for letting us barge in on your show this morning. Steve, it's good luck to you tonight with the show
at
7:30.
Thank you, it's great to be on the Swap Shop. I've always wanted to be on the Swap Shop.
Super, well, you've been on it now. Thank you very much.
Ta-ra.
And thank you to everybody here at Radio 1 who's been so helpful to us this morning. I'll see you next week. Meanwhile, I'll leave you with Noel. See you, Noel.
Thank you very much indeed, gentlemen. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Steve. And thank you, of course, to Keith, who will be out and about somewhere next week. I wonder where. Certainly won't be at Radio 1, but I'll be in those studios tomorrow between 10 and 1. Why can't I plug my own show? For those people who want to keep the pop music going, do you remember this one? It was out last year. A great sound from the Gibson Brothers. And it's Cuba. Well, it didn't require incredible intelligence to realise that number was called Do You Love Me? And it comes from Girl. And we got a lady coming up now. My final guest on today's Swap Shop is June Whitfield. And she's here. And she's also here with Terry Scott.
me aboard, Bran.
No, June.
Terry, if you are determined to go through with this, then I am determined to go with you.
God, you're magnificent.
I know.
I knew she wouldn't let you down.
Which is more than I can say for you, you worm. Hang on, June. We're going up.
And is that all the thanks my Brian gets for all he's done for you?
No, Tina. If he waits for a couple of minutes, I shall spit on him from a great height.
It's all right for you, Terry. You're not up for election to the inner circle of the Rotary Club, are you?
They're driving away. Hey!
Shh, boy, let them go. We've got enough to worry about at the moment.
Is this thing safe?
Safe as houses.
Oh, Terry.
What?
Nothing, just... Oh, Terry.
Yes, June.
Terry.
What?
It stopped.
Hang on, love.
What's happening?
Don't worry. I know what I'm doing.
Oh, do be careful, darling.
Hold on, you!
I am holding on!
I'll try something else.
Yes.
June, a very good morning to you.
Good morning.
You're the last person I expected to start off with the question, do you do all your own stunts?
Well, it wasn't really going to be a stunt. I mean, it turned out as a bit of a stunt because our director said, we're going to do a little bit of night filming and we're just going to get you in a builder's cradle and we'll only be about 10 feet above the ground, you know, and we said, oh, well, fine. And so we got in the cradle and we looked up and there he had a camera right at the top of the tower and I thought, that's an awful long way to shoot, you know, and he gradually said, well, will I go a little bit higher? I think we'll just go a little, all right, you two, and we're up there by then, you know, there's not a lot you can say, yes, fine.
Well, that's fairly exceptional, isn't it? You don't normally have to risk life and limb.
Yes. The only thing that I was sad about was that it was at night, so all you could see were lights, and it would have been much more fun if you could have had a vista laid out for you, you know.
Whereabouts did you film it?
At the Tolworth Tower.
Off the A3? Yes, I know it.
Yes.
Well, you've had a very long working relationship with Terry, haven't you?
Yes, I have, yes, since about 1969.
Do you find that people in everyday life assume that you are husband and wife?
Very often, yes, they do. They say, if I'm out with my husband, they say, you know, how's your husband? And I say, fine, or where's your husband? And I say, he's right here. And they say, oh, no, not him, the real one.
Yes, they probably think you're being a bit naughty. Right?
Yes, quite, yes.
It is a strikingly successful relationship. What do you think it is that makes two people sort of gel like that?
I don't know. It's odd, isn't it? Because people say, they use the expression, you go so well together, you know. And, in fact, our real spouses are not a lot like each other. I mean, Maggie, Terry's real wife, is not very like me. And I don't think my husband, Tim, is very like Terry, so... You know, it's just one of those things. But well, we get on well together.
I was very lucky a few weeks ago to see a clip. In fact, we showed it earlier of the colander thing in the kitchen. And I saw a clip that went wrong of that. You had about three takes at
it. Did you?
And the great thing was that you really did appear to be enjoying it. there was some fluff over some words or something, and you really did it. I mean, do you find that you really enjoy every single episode?
Oh, yes, it's tremendous fun when we're doing it. And especially if the audience is enjoying it, I think that's the main thing. If you feel that the people there in the studio with you are having fun, then it makes it much more fun.
Well,
this was
it, in this actual clip, Terry got the giggles, and it almost seems as if it was caused by the audience falling
yes,
about that.
I know. Sometimes Terry gets a giggle over a word. You know, he says sometimes, especially if it's somebody's name. He's worse than I am over that. Sometimes, you know, we have to do it again because he gets to somebody's name, is it Alice or something very ordinary, and he'll say Mabel or something.
He breaks out. Yeah. All right, we'd like to grab a telephone over there.
Oh, yes.
I've had a few questions. There's a couple of things I want to ask also, but we've got someone on line 4.
Hello?
Hello, who are you?
Gavin Caldwell.
Hello, Gavin. You're through to June Whitfield.
Hello Gavin. June. Hello.
Apart from doing television, do you like doing pantomime?
Well, now, Gavin, I haven't done a pantomime since 19... That was a long, long time ago. And would you believe I played Cinderella? But I haven't done a pantomime since. But I do work in the theatre sometimes. And it's a very, very difficult one to answer. The theatre's great fun, but it can get a bit tedious, the actual thing of going to the theatre every day. You know, it's for a long time. It can get a bit tiresome, but once she's doing the show, it's very good.
I'd just like to say I think you're great and happy ever after.
Well, that's jolly nice of you, Gavin. Thank you very much.
Bye.
And I hope you keep watching Terry and June, too.
Yes.
OK, thank you, Gavin.
Bye.
Goodbye. Line 5.
Bye.
Hello. Hello, who's this?
Graham Hughes.
Good morning, Graham. What's your question?
Eric June.
Hello, Graham.
I wondered if you've ever written any of your own material.
No, I'm afraid not. No, very, very untalented in that direction. Occasionally rewrite the odd line or the odd something, but unfortunately not. I only wish I could. Do you write anything?
No.
You don't? Well, if you have any leanings in that direction, I should, because they're very few and far between.
Are there any particular script writers who make you laugh? Or anyone in particular you've worked with?
Script writers who make me laugh? Oh, my goodness, isn't that difficult? Yes, I mean, definitely. Frank Muir and Dennis Norton
made
me laugh many
days.
Years ago and still do. I think they're very, very funny. And Galton and Simpson make me laugh, too. And a lot of the newer writers. I think they're all so talented to even be able to put pen to paper, you know. Because staring at a blank sheet of paper and trying to write something down is very different. Yeah.
Thank you very much for your question.
Thank you.
Thank you, goodbye.
Bye.
Line 2.
June?
Yes.
Who's this?
Sam Southwick.
It's who? Sam?
Southwick.
Hello,
Sam.
Sam
Southwick. Hello, Sam.
Hi,
how are you?
Sam.
Very well. Do you think your lines are funny and do you laugh at rehearsals?
Oh, my goodness.
Good
how
question,
difficult.
So.
They're two different questions, really, aren't they? Sometimes... It isn't the lines that are funny, Sam, it's the situations that are sometimes funny, and that makes the line funny. And the answer to laughing at rehearsals is yes, certainly sometimes, especially if I'm looking at Terry and he's reacting to something in a slightly funny way, and then yes, definitely. Get the giggles.
Yeah,
yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
Line 6.
This is Sandy Shasha.
Hello, Sandy.
Sandy. I wanted to ask June, when you were young, did you have any dreams that you wanted to become an actress?
Any dreams?
Yes.
Ooh, that's a difficult one. Do you know, I think I always thought I was going to be. I used to go to dancing class very early when I was at school and things like that. And I went to drama school. I think my mum always wanted to be an actress. And it was almost a foregone conclusion that I would do all the things that might help me to become an actress. And I don't think I ever thought about being anything else, except when my father said to me, I hope you're keeping up your shorthand and typing. You know, just
in case.
Yes.
It is a dodgy profession. Have you ever had long periods where you haven't been able to work?
Well, is there any wood about this?
Yes, a wooden type.
I've been incredibly lucky, I must say. I haven't... Did I say, when I used to get a new contract, you know, for another show... We're not on the phone now, are we? No.
Well, I didn't know whether you were considering it an extension of that question.
He'd always say, if I said, oh, look, Dad, you know, this last one was £8 and I've got 12 now, sort of thing, and he'd say, yes, you're keeping up your shorthand and typing, aren't you, dear? You know?
Yeah, get a proper job.
Yes, get a proper job.
Let's try someone on line 3.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello,
who are you?
Melissa Cowley.
Hello?
Melissa?
Hello, hello, June.
Hello.
I was wondering if Terry and you are anything like the parts you play.
Well, they must be something like us. Terry always says that they're an extension of ourselves. You know, that Terry's like him only much more so.
Yes.
And I'm a bit like me only much more so.
Yes. But
we hope it picks out all the best and worst of our natures and, you know, sort of enlarges it a bit.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Melissa.
Thank you.
Line
Bye.
1.
Hello, June.
Hello. Who's
Hello.
This?
Susan O'Brien here.
Susan?
I just wondered whether you preferred a live audience or television and comedy or drama.
Who?
prefer a live audience. Do you mean to not? Usually, I must admit, most things I do are with a live audience. We haven't really got... Well, we have got a live audience today. We've got the rest of the studio, haven't we? Mm. But I think the answer is yes, I do like a live audience, although I would love to try a comedy television show without a live audience. So it's a difficult one to answer because I haven't tried it, but I'd love to, is the answer.
Can I just say, June, that all the patients at North Ormsby Hospital wish you well in all you do?
Oh, thank you. Will you please give my love to them and, you know, wish them all well from me?
Thank you very much.
Thank you
Bye-bye.
For your call.
Thank you. Bye.
That leads us on to a swap. Oh, have you brought along
some
personal item you're willing to get rid of?
I have, actually. I brought the script of the flying carpets, the clip
the piece that
you
that
saw
we saw,
earlier, if anybody's interested. And I brought... I don't know if people collect stamps. Somebody might be interested in that. It's just a commemorative stamps for the International Stamp Exhibition. I'm not very up in stamps, but
lovely.
I thought somebody
might
like that. And the other thing is a camera, which I'm not very good at.
A mini camera.
And I thought perhaps somebody might like it who would, be better at it than I am.
Jolly good. Right. So have you actually managed to take a roll of film with that?
Well, yes, but I'm not terribly good at it.
You've emptied it. I mean, not half your holiday snaps.
Oh,
there,
no. There's a new film with it, yeah.
I need a question, please.
Yes, the question is, now listen carefully. In the series Terry and June, what is our surname? And it's a slightly trick question because it's not the same surname as in Happy Ever After.
Right.
Okay.
That's postcards, please. Postcards on that. Mm. And you could be in for the script. You can do a bit of rehearsing and practicing yourselves, the winner of that.
Redo it, yes.
You briefly mentioned the radio thing there. I mean, to millions of people, you remember for that part as F?
Yes, I know, yes.
How did
yes.
that come about? Did you produce that character yourself from the...
I did, really, yes. It came about because the script arrived, and you always look at a script and you think, I see. Now, how am I going to do that? And it was really my mother... that it was somebody she knew, and she said, why don't you do it like Mrs. So-and-so? I said, I can't do that. Nobody'd ever believe it.
Lovely.
And she said, oh, yes, they would. So that's really how it was born. And incidentally, I never thought that I would be talking to a ferret and two rats, which I did today, and they're quite charming, if anybody wants to know.
Were you asked to be involved with the sort of the bring back of it recently?
No, because it was really, it's another generation, isn't it? Unless they'd done Ron and Ed in 30 years' time, then there might have been. But it's all right for Jimmy, you see, because he's... Pa Glum could be any age,
right.
But it's a bit tricky for Ron and Heath, I think. She's got to be a bit younger than me.
Indeed. Yeah. Do you miss the radio aspect? Because you don't do quite so much radio now, do you?
I don't, and yes, I do. I like radio. I do odd things on radio, but not enough. No, I'd love to do more radio.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, yes. Phone time.
Oh, hello.
They're working well. Line four.
Hello.
Hello, who are you?
Who's that?
Wendy Joy.
Hello, Wendy. Right, you're now through to June Whitfield.
Hello, Wendy.
Have you ever been on a live programme and made a very bad mistake that you couldn't put right?
What's that?
Oh, have you ever made a bad mistake you couldn't put right?
Oh, certainly. But I don't think I'll talk about that.
No, quite. They're the embarrassing ones.
A bad mistake? Do you mean on the... Yes. Yes, I have made a bad mistake because occasionally... I can giggle, which is very naughty, and one shouldn't. But there are certain people, and I know Dick Emery was on the programme a few weeks ago, and he makes me giggle because, you know, it's something that you look at somebody and there's a little giggle behind their eyes, and there's somebody else I'm working with at the minute, which is Leslie Phillips, and he does it too. And I know it's awful, but there are times when I must admit I giggle, and that is a very bad mistake. Because one shouldn't.
Dick Emery did that to me. He got me giggling last
week. Well,
there
you are,
you wonder what he's thinking. And you start
Who makes you giggle? You must have friends that make you giggle, do you?
One of my friends.
Yes.
Just sets you off.
Yeah.
Well, it's bad news at school, but it's got to be bad news if you're doing a bit of acting.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Shani, for phoning us. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Wendy. Bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Line five.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, who are you?
Iona Sutherland.
Hello, Iona. What's your question?
Hello, Jane.
Hello, Iona.
Do you wear your own clothes on the programme?
Well, sometimes I do and sometimes I don't. Some of them are supplied by the BBC and we usually go shopping together. And sometimes I wear mine, so it's very difficult to say, really.
Rather awful ones for the BBC, so that.
Is there anything specific you could think of? I can't.
It's gone quiet.
No, never mind. Stumped. No, but I mean, that's the answer. It's a mixture.
Yeah. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Hi.
Absolutely stunned. Line two.
Hello?
Who are you?
Identify yourself.
Anthony Casagrande.
Right, hello, Anthony. A super surname.
Isn't it? Casagrande. That's lovely. Yeah.
What's your question, Anthony?
Have you got any other ambitions, Jane?
Any other ambitions? Well, I always say just to sort of keep on working, you know, keep on turning it over, really. No tremendous ambition, except I would love to be in a saga, in a television costume serial. I think that'd be gorgeous.
That's, okay. That's your answer, Anthony. That's plaudive as well. Yeah. Thank you very much. Well, that's all we've got time for with the phone
Thank
calls,
Thank you. Jim. Bye.
On that specific subject, do you regret that people tend to find you a sort of happy, cheerful person? And do you think you miss out on doing serious roles?
No, I don't really... I don't particularly want to do a serious type role. I would just like to do a costume type thing, you know, a madly elegant...
A bit dressing up,
yes. I like a bit of dressing up.
And the one question which I'm surprised we didn't get on the phones, who makes you laugh? You've worked with some of the greatest British comedians.
Oh, well, I've already said Dick Emery, but I mean, he makes me laugh when he's actually meant to make me laugh as well. And Frankie Howard makes me laugh. Terry makes me laugh, but when you work with someone as closely as with Terry, you're sometimes laughing because you know what's going on behind what's going on, you know. Mm. And incidentally, I'm sure everybody would love to know that Terry is well and much, much better, and I was working with him only last week. So he's in great form.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much indeed for coming along. Have you got a busy weekend?
Two shows today.
Really?
Yes, in
the
theatre.
A matinee and an evening?
Yes, yes. No, well, no, it's 5:45 and 8:45. It's a bit of a slog on Friday and Saturday.
Oh, thank you very much for
Sunday's
finding
Sunday's nice.
Thank you for finding the time to come along here.
Delighted. Wonderful.
June,
love your show.
Thanks a lot.
I forgot. Let me say something.
Hold everything.
No, you know all those little things you've got round your thingy?
I've heard.
Well, I brought you another one.
Lovely. Oh, very nice. What? Oh, it goes that way around. What is it?
Yeah, I don't know, really. I just thought he was sort of...
Thank you for your know what it is.
Yes.
And here's a bit of your acting going on right now.
Oh, dear.
Behold the Starship Enterprise!
It's beautiful! It's beautiful!
Yeah, and mechanically sound too. Incorporating all the latest scientific developments. Little Magnus sits in here and propels the back wheels with his hands and steers the front ones with his feet.
Darling, it's brilliant!
Yes, ma'am. All the finest brains in the galaxy have created the starship to boldly go where no man has gone before at approximately 2 miles an hour with the wind behind him.
What's it made of?
Well, apart from the basic wooden frame, it's mainly chicken wire and tin foil. I spent a fortune on the stuff. There's enough in there to fence in 60 chickens and cook them afterwards.
It's so sturdy.
Oh, yes, yeah, strong enough to withstand gamma rays, sonic blasts, and little boys chucking stones at it.
Hey, Terry, isn't that my colander?
Well, it was your colander. Now it's the only radar scanner in the world that strains greens at speed.
There's just one thing, darling.
What?
Well, I hardly like to mention it,
really. What?
How are you going to get it out of the kitchen?
Well, have you room on your shoulder for a stopping hysterical wreck?
Thank you once again to June for coming along. And that's just about it from this edition of Swap Shop. Can I just remind you about the awards? We want your vote. And do have a think back over the year. Don't just think of people who have been on television recently. Think back over the last year. The awards are meant to represent a whole year of television. It's only open to people under the age of 16. You'll find the coupon in the current edition of the Radio Times sitting on page 26. If you'd like to fill that in, stick it on a postcard, send it in to our Swap Shop, BBC TV, London, W12, S04E21-8QT. We'll be back next week. We've got the Revillos on the programme, and we've also got Peter Holden, who runs the Young Ornithologists Club. We've got lots of exciting things going on. I wonder where Keith will be with his swaparama. Certainly not at Radio 1, but I will be tomorrow morning between 10 and 1. From this swap shop, I wish you goodbye.